Good morning. Welcome to worship with New Hope Presbyterian. We're glad you're here. If you haven't already, I would urge you to go to YouTube and subscribe to our Experience New Hope channel. We post content there throughout the week from Pastor Eddie on 2 Minute Tuesdays with Pastor Mike on Thursdays and Drop the Mic, as well as some fun and silly videos with our staff throughout the week. We're going to check in with our missions director for a quick update.
My name is Jim Mayer, and I'm director of missions here at New Hope. And I'd like to give you a little update on the missional side of New Hope's ministry, especially during this COVID-19 crisis. New Hope makes annual commitments to more than 20 different partners who serve God both locally and internationally. We have committed to continue our support for those whom we have made pledges to, but we are honored to see how God is working through these partners. One of our partners in the Middle East has been providing food bags for the needy refugees. And locally, there are all kinds of things happening. We continue to help provide food for the homeless in our community and even been making masks or gloves for hundreds of our local heroes. And we just want to thank you so much for all you do to make this ongoing ministry possible.
We're ready to head inside for worship. Pastor Mike will be kicking off the first service in our series, The New Normal. Our hope is that this series brings biblical encouragement as well as practical tips as you and your family navigate this new normal.
This is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in this day. We are delighted to have you join us, and we join you in your homes and on your devices this Sunday morning as we continue to celebrate the resurrected Christ.
Thank you.
call to worship this morning comes from Isaiah 53, verse 5. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon Him, and by His wounds we are healed. Therefore, we praise God, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for in His great mercy He has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. Oh God, we praise You. You who have loved us in Christ Jesus, even before the creation of the world. In You we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the grace that You have lavished on us in Christ Jesus. We come together today to give You thanks that even in a day where the discouragements of a pandemic hovers over all of us, that we come with hope because our hope is in the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so our prayer this day is the prayer that Your Word leads us to pray, that the eyes of our hearts would be enlightened so that we would know the hope to which You have called us, the riches of Your glorious inheritance in us. And the incomparably great power for those who believe, for that power that is at work within us, is the same power that raised Jesus from the dead. And so we come this day, O Father, O Son, and O Holy Spirit, by your strength and by your power and according to your gospel, to worship and praise you and to enter into your presence. For we pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And all God's people prayed, Amen.
Cross. exchange it someday for a crown.
Well, God, in these days we pray for one another. How do you pray in a pandemic? The strong name of the Lord Jesus Christ, who is our great high priest, who rules and reigns at the Father's right hand with nail prints in his hands and feet, reminding us that you who intercede for us identify with us, and that you are for us, and that you are with us. Lord, we believe. Help us to believe more deeply. We lift our brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus and our own church family who are struggling. Mike and Steve Randolph and the loss of their mother. For Wendy Franz and the loss of her brother. For Sharon Bowman, who lost a nephew to the coronavirus. We pray, oh God, for Ken and Nancy Holman's son, Kurtz, for your healing mercies as he struggles with the virus. We pray for our own Heather Hackett as she has endured weeks of treatment. We pray in the strong name of Christ for your healing. We pray for Barbara Gannon, who had surgery this past Friday for cancer. For Dave Maul, who began this week radiation treatments. For Carol and Charlie Beck's son, who is struggling with cancer. For those of our own who are battling cancer and their own struggles. We pray, Lord Jesus, that in these days that we would be a people who not only think of ourselves and pray for ourselves, but to pray for those that we know in our neighborhood and in our own area. We pray, oh God, for our medical professionals, and for our school teachers, and those that are on the front lines of either battling the illness or adjusting to the illness. We pray for our moms and dads who are learning how to do school from home. We pray for those that battle not the chaos of home, but the isolation of home. We pray, Lord Jesus, that you would send your comfort of the Holy Spirit to bring comfort and encouragement upon all of our church family in these days, as we pray for those in our nation and in our state and our community who are leading us. For we pray in the strong name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Today, I hope you'll find comfort in the truth that people all around the world, along with us, are battling this pandemic. And at the same time, Christians all around the world gather together and at the core of their beliefs is an old creed, the Apostles' Creed. And so join with us this day as we say together, we believe. Thank you.
So, you know, this whole lockdown thing is very strange. It has caused us all to be home a lot more than we ever have been. But I will say this, it's allowed me to answer that age-old question. What does your dog do when you're at work and the kids are at school? I can answer that question now. She sleeps. She sleeps constantly. But it's led to a second question. Because now I'm asking, what does she do on her day off? Sleep? Apparently, that's her job. But being around the house this much, it's allowed us to do a lot of other things as well. Kind of like think about what colors the wall could become. Kind of look around and think about all those honey-do lists that now we seem to have the time to maybe be able to get to. Time to spend a lot of time together. And that's a good thing. But it's not necessarily our normal thing. So for the next couple of weeks, Pastor Eddie and I are going to be talking about the new normal. What does it look like to live in a Jesus-honoring household in these days? A lot of us are anxious for things to get back to the way that they were, where we were working 70 hours a week, where we were filling our schedule so full that we didn't have time for anything, where we were running around and spending just a little bit more money than we had with no financial margin, where we would skip dinners every week because we were just so busy. Is that really the normal that we want to get back to? Pastor Eddie and I are going to be spending some time talking about what does a biblical house look like? What are the house rules in the new normal? What does it mean to watch our words in the new normal? What does it mean to look at how we're going to pay for all of this? Because, you know, at the end of our lockdown, there's going to be an economic shift. We don't know what it's going to be. What does it look like for us to operate in the new normal? Now, this morning, I want to spend a little bit of time thinking about one verse. We're going to talk about more than one verse, but there's one verse in particular that I want to encourage you to memorize. In fact, we're going to say it together. I'm going to say it, and then we're going to say it together. We're going to put it up on the screen so you get a chance to say it together at home. Okay, you ready for this? Psalm 33:22 says this, "May your unfailing love be with us, Lord, even as we put our hope in you." Let's just say that together. May your unfailing love be with us, Lord, even as we put our hope in you. You know, when we think about hope, when we think about hope in the old normal or hope in the new normal, it can get to be pretty real, can't it? I mean, hope, how do you maintain hope in a world that seems to be hopelessly broken? How do we maintain hope when the things that we put our hope into seem to disappoint in so many different ways? If you've ever placed your hope in something and that something came crashing down, you understand this tension. You see, in a world that is increasingly separated, in a world that is increasingly isolated, in a world that is just not normal, how do we try to maintain hope in people? How do we try to maintain hope in a relationship? How do we try to maintain hope in a hopelessly broken world? And maybe most of all, how do we maintain hope when the future is at best uncertain and at worst terrifying from what we know now? So before we go too far down this road, I want to just give you a working definition of hope. It's just my definition. It's some stuff that I've culled together from different readers, John Piper, Tim Keller, other folks that I respect very greatly, and put it all together into a working definition of hope. And this is going to be our working definition of hope this morning. Hope is the person or the thing in which your expectations are centered. The person or the thing in which your expectations are centered. As you get older, you know, one way to think about that is hope is the wall that your ladder is leaning against. In other words, that thing that you're expecting to prop you up, to prop up your dreams, to pop up your anticipations, those things that you expect to hold you up through life. It may be a relationship. It may be a person. It may be a career, it may be a 401k, it may be all these different things that in and of themselves are not bad, but they become the wall to which we are leaning our ladder. And as you get older, you begin to move your ladder, and you moved it from someone else's commitment to yourself, You know, we don't even realize that we have this ladder leaned up against the wall. Think about it when you're born, or if you've got young children. They're putting all of their hope in you right now. You put all of your hope in your parents at a young age, or your mama at a young age, to provide for you. You didn't know where the food came from. You just knew the food was there. You didn't know how the air conditioning worked and all. You just knew that it was there because somebody was always providing that for you. And in a very real and good way, you're leaning your ladder against the hope of what your folks can provide. As you get older and you start to become more independent, you start leaning that ladder in other places. You start putting it towards your own merits, the things that you're able to accomplish, your own skill sets, your own abilities. And as you get even older, you start bringing other people into that, and pretty soon our ladder is all over the place. It's not leaning against that original wall. And that's not a bad thing. But as we get older and older, we seem to put more of our hope there. More of our foundation there, more of our hope leaning against that wall. And it's when times like this that come along that shake those very foundations that for many of us, we have the opportunity to say, you know, just where is my hope? Where is my ladder of hope leaning against? As you get older, you start thinking about your ability to connect with other people, your ability to get a scholarship, your ability to do well in school, your ability to maintain relationships, your ability to attract attention to yourself, your ability to marry someone that has promise, maybe even your inheritance. And we make a decision to lean the ladder of our hope into something that we think will support our ambition or our future or our aspirations or our hopes and dreams for the future. The only time we ever think about hope is when we begin to feel helpless and hopeless. Dr. Rosario Butterfield wrote a book. She said it this way: the sense of hopelessness and despair or helplessness is simply that feeling that the thing I leaned my ladder against wasn't coming through for me. And for a lot of people in this season, that's the way it feels. Everything that they thought, everything that we thought, everything that I thought was just sure that every day was going to be just like the day before has come crumbling and crashing down. And still, we don't know what the full fallout is going to be. And so when we think about all of those things that we can intentionally lean our ladder against, we come back to know what it is that Psalm 33 says. He says, our hope is in you, O Lord. Our hope is in you. You know, this whole COVID-19 crisis, it's really not anything new. Every generation, it seems, has had some sort of a major crisis to think about. Now, it's different because it's us. It's different because the social and the cultural circumstances are very different. But it's something that has happened time and time again. And it's unearthed for our country, for our world, and for our neighbors, and maybe even for ourselves, what wall our ladder is actually leaning against. See, it's only when the thing that we leaned our ladder against that doesn't come through for us that we begin to experience and think about the whole subject of hope. Otherwise, we just go day to day with our ladder leaning against somewhere, and honestly, we're totally unaware of what it's actually leaning against. And yet God says in Psalm 33, he says, may your unfailing love be with us, Lord, even as we put our hope in you. Now think about this. Just about 100 years ago, there was another disease that ravished the West, ravished the world. The Spanish flu went through, and according to the stats, 675,000 people died in the United States. Worldwide, 50 million people died from the Spanish flu. In fact, there are postcards and letters sent from that day where the government shut down movement, where church services were canceled. There's even a recorded incident where a man was shot for not wearing a mask outside because they were so afraid of the Spanish flu. Now, I'm not saying that this has the potential to be anything like that. What I am saying, though, is that history is repeating itself. And if history is repeating itself, then we need to look back and see, where is our ladder actually leaning? Where is our ladder actually leaning? Now, you can imagine as a preacher, I'm going to take you to the Bible to talk about that a little bit. The New Testament, the Old Testament, the entire Bible talks a great deal about life in the new normal, about life when things were not normal. In fact, did you ever realize that every single author of the Bible wrote in times of duress, times of great stress? I can't tell you a single time in the Bible where you open it up and it says, and Abraham and Sarah had peanut butter and jelly sandwiches because it was just another day. That doesn't happen. Because every story in the New Testament and the Old Testament comes out of a time of great change, of great upheaval of one type or another. And so today I want to take us to Romans chapter 8. If you've got your Bible, you can open up there. I'm not going to teach through the whole thing because that would take Pastor Eddie and I about 2 years to teach all the way through Romans 8. And we don't have that kind of time today. But I do want to take some verses, and I want to encourage you to go back and read the entire chapter to put this into its full context. But I want to talk a little bit about some verses at the end of Romans chapter 8 that I think can bring some of these things into context, especially as we think about our hope. Where is our hope placed? So if you look down to Romans chapter 8, verse 20, let me just set that up a little bit, because it talks about in the early part, Paul, the author of Romans, the letter that he wrote to the people in Rome, talks about a thing that happened way back in Genesis chapter 3. And in Genesis chapter 3, the Bible is very clear, and it says sin entered the world. Adam and Eve sinned against God. Now, when we think about sin, we think about it as an event. I went out and I sinned. In fact, a lot of times Pastor Eddie and I get questions. Hey, Mike, if I do this, is it going to be a sin? Which is, I think, actually just saying, hey, is it okay if I do this? So anyway, that's another whole message for another different time. But sin, according to the Bible, the way that we look at sin is an incident. The way that the Bible, the way that God looks at sin is a disease. Sin is a disease, and it entered the world through the one act of Adam, and it tainted everything. It changed everything. It made things that were beautiful toxic. And it changed everything. And so in Romans 8, Paul says this, for the creation was subjected to frustration. All of creation, not just humans, all of creation was subjected to frustration. Did you know that that's what you feel when you feel like, why aren't things working out the way that I want them to? That's frustration. Why aren't things going the way that they should? That's frustration. All of creation was subjected to that frustration. And then that verse goes on and it says, in hope that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay. You know, we don't have to look far to see the decay, do we? I heard about a grandmother and her granddaughter sitting on the couch one day, and they were looking through the wedding album of when the grandparents got married. And the little girl, maybe 4 or 5 years old, she looks at a picture of the bride and she says, who is that beautiful lady? And the grandmother says, well, that's me. And she looks at the picture again, and there's a man, a young man in a suit with a full head of hair. And she says, well, who is that guy? And she says, well, that's your grandfather. And she says, well, then who's that fat old bald guy that calls me granddaddy? You see, decay happens, and we know it. Decay is real. Decay is that thing that when you get to a certain age, like I'm getting to be or may have already gotten to, when you look in the mirror and you look back and you go, who is that? Decay is that thing that is all around us, and decay ultimately even leads to death. All of creation is subjected to this type of decay. That's what Paul is saying there in Romans chapter 8. And then in 22 and 23, he goes on, and I'm not going to read it for you, but he said, this tension creates in us a longing for something better. In fact, the way that the Bible says it, it says that the Holy Spirit himself intercedes with groans on our behalf because of this longing. We know things are not right. We know things are not the way they should be. We know things are not the ancient normal. But then he goes on, for in this hope, we were saved. For in this hope, we were saved. The hope that we celebrated last week at Easter, the hope of the resurrection, the hope of what Jesus Christ has done for us. In this hope, Jesus Christ dying for our sins to take away the penalty of death and decay and sin. In this hope, we are saved. In this hope, we place our hope. In this hope, we place our ladder against the wall of this hope. And then he goes down into verse 831, and you can almost hear the music rise and all of creation getting on the edge of their seat, finding out what's going to happen next. And in 831, he says this: if God is for us, who can be against us? If God is for us, who can be against us? And then he tells us why God is for us, and how God is for us, and how much God is for us. In verse 32, he says, he who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also along with him graciously give us all things? All things. So does that mean that we should not have ambition? Does that mean that we should not have goals and drive and all of those other things? Does that mean that we shouldn't engage in our culture? No, of course not. But it does mean that we should not put our hope there. It does mean that we should not be leaning our ladder against the hope of finances, against the hope of success, against the hope of career, against the hope of normal. It means that the only sure place to lean our ladder is against the hope of Jesus Christ, against the hope of God. In fact, it goes on in Romans all the way down to verse 38. Listen to how sure our hope is in Christ. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Today, this whole crisis, the whole abnormal normality, the whole lockdown, the whole anxiety about what's coming after this lockdown, that all may have come about to get our attention, to get our country's attention, to get our world's attention, maybe even to get my attention or your attention as to what wall our ladder is leaning against. It may very well be that God is using this time to say, now is the time. Now is the time in this pause in the normal, in this pause in the time that we would normally be just running ourselves ragged. Now is the time to come to me and say, God, I want to shift my ladder. I realize my ladder has been leaning against a wall that ultimately is going to disappoint. That ultimately one of those things, life or death, things above, things below, something is going to come between me and it. And I want to move my ladder against your wall. I want to move my ladder to the place that neither life nor death, nor things above, nor things below, nor nothing in all creation can separate me from your hope. And so we come to our verse this morning. May your unfailing love be with us, Lord, even as we put our hope in you. May your unfailing love be with us, O Lord, even as we put our hope in you. Moving that ladder is as simple as saying, God, I have trusted the wrong things. I have trusted myself. I have trusted my stuff. I have trusted my career. I've retrusted my relationships. And all of those things are ultimately going to disappoint. All of those things will leave me hopeless. Today, Lord, I want to come to you. I want to come to you and ask that you would receive me in the grace and the love and the forgiveness of Jesus Christ. Forgive me for building my life on things that will not last. Draw me close to you. And I know that God will hear that prayer. And God will say, welcome home. Welcome home. Put your trust in me. I will never disappoint. You will never be shaken. In Jesus' name. Amen. And now may our God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him. And may you overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen and amen.